Yeah. So I guess I can start with the first keynote. And before doing that, I would like to, well, it's a great honor to present the first keynote at Microservices 2019. And I would like to take another chance to thank everyone that helped the organization. So from the students to the keynote speakers, you attendees, and my fellow organizers. And as you might know, this edition of Microservices is intertwined with the meeting of Microservices that started back in 2016, as Fabrizio told us. And the event is driven by speakers coming to the conference, coming to the event, introducing a topic, and then discussing on that. And this is the first of five keynotes spread over the 3 days of the conference. And the first speaker, the format. So the speeches are 50 minutes long, and then you have 10 minutes for the questions. And so the first speaker is Olaf Zimmermann, and Olaf is a independent consultant, an institute partner, and a professor at the University of Applied Sciences in Rapperswil in Switzerland, and is a member of the editorial board and has his own column at the IEEE software magazine. And Olaf is one of the most renowned researchers in the area of service-oriented architectures and microservices. And while he is an academic at heart, Olaf has a background as a consultant and software architect, working for companies like ABB, the ABB Group, and IBM. And as we would say in the microservices community, he is a bridge builder between academia and industry, and a stark example of the spirit of this kind of events. And I leave the stage to Olaf. Thank you all.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for your kind words, Saverio. I feel flattered, and I sincerely hope the funding agencies are listening. So, rather loaded title of my presentation here, domain-specific service decomposition with microservice API patterns. Let's see whether we can decipher a little bit and organize. So since hexagons seem to be important, right, I even succeeded already by putting the community logo on my title chart here, I decided not to show the traditional agenda, but present to you the architecture of the presentation in the form of hexagons too, right? So we're gonna kick off with some real world examples from my consulting days, two case studies and actual service contracts that are made up for the presentation, but they're very close to the real ones. And that puts us in a position to do some definitional work. As Fabrizio pointed out, I wasn't as smart as he and his colleagues in that first conference to stop after 30 minutes. The definition work took me a little longer. So some SOA classics and then what I call microservices tenets to discuss a little bit the relationship between the two things. And then the heart of the talk, after some myth busting, I have some positions about SOA versus microservices that might differ from some of those that you guys have, might have. So we'll see whether I can provide evidence for my positions, for my statements. After that short excerpt, with myth-busting, I'm going to go into our favorite topics, service size. Stefan Tilkoff, in his presentation, already mentioned that size does matter. That's an important characteristic of the four types of microservices or service architectures that we can think of. Loose coupling already got mentioned in the morning. So a little bit of foundational work on this, and then we're going to go into the pattern language that I've been working on for the last 2.5 years, as a matter of fact. With some colleagues, and we have a little community volunteer project going on. We look at known uses, at real-world public APIs, and also enterprise APIs to find the commonalities in the designs. So that's going to be the second part of the talk, and then I'm going to go into some research challenges, open research problems, where I have ongoing work or ideas for research, and I very much look for insights, feedback, comments. You guys might be working on similar things, right? If we recall the two meta models in the morning, service modeling is of interest to me. And then service identification, we always get educated and informed that everything we need to do is you know, throw this term domain-driven design and bounded context into the mix, and then we're good. But nobody tells us how to find these domain-driven design abstractions like bounded context and aggregates. So that's an interesting one, service identification. Again, bringing us back to the topic of service size, service granularity. Time permitting, I'm also going to go into brownfield discussion, right? Not greenfield service identification and forward engineering, but also bottom-up, you know, modernizing existing systems, refactoring them to the microservices paradigm. So I hope it's a good mix of you know, industry and academic topics. Without further ado, let's jump right into the first case study, the first architecture. Project took place not too far from here, about 100 kilometers away. We're in the banking industry. It's a financial services provider. The light blue parts are a shared company, as a matter of fact, and a set of software solutions supporting, at the time of the project, about 230 banks, retail banks, spread all over Germany. And so they're sharing one backend, and they're all in charge of their own IT strategy. So up here you see some of the technologies that were en vogue at the time when we did the project. And you can throw in a couple more languages now. So one of the main reasons for doing the going the SOA way, service-oriented architecture way, was to overcome this technical heterogeneity, right? This mass amount of front-end technologies. And they were all supposed to use one single interface and contract language to talk to the more than nowadays more than 1,000 business functions in the back end. At the time we did the project, we had a couple hundred, and we will see examples in a minute. So one of my key messages here is overcoming technical differences and dealing with different implementation platforms and programming languages is not at all a novel trait or tenet of the microservices movement, and that's exactly what we've been up to with the SOA style 10-15 years ago. Same for this mantra of business alignment. We want our interface contracts or operations to be meaningful to non-IT guys, people that don't have a degree in computer science. So let's see how my examples do on the next chart. Quite a few services. Let's start with the Hello World up here, right? So when we did a proof of concept, we started with three use cases for that project. Whether the architectural style is right for this client to decide this, to play with the technology and learn it. Then we have the Hello World. That was our get account balance. You get a custom ID, send it in, and you get a number, you know, the amount of money that's left back. Not too difficult. Then the other extreme is deep analysis of the banking behavior of the customer, right? So simple data goes into the service operation, but a rather complex structure comes back. What I call here banking, product, portfolio, collection, whatever that is. Hopefully business aligned, but you can imagine that's deeply nested, deeply structured. So that's kind of sends the message, yes, we can be fine-grained, but you know, we should clarify a little bit what fine-grained or coarse-grained means, so small and large. So I'm trying to do this here by establishing these two dimensions. In fact, I talk about two types of granularity, business granularity and technical granularity. With business granularity, I mean, what is this service actually doing in terms of responsibilities or domain model elements covered? You can translate that, if you prefer, into database tables. If you're an object-oriented person, you can think about the true domain model, right? Entities, their relationships, classes, those kind of things. Here we might get away with one if we just look at an account. Here we probably won't, because we have to look at a couple of tables, right? So that's spectrum. That's my message here. Even in the old SOA days, we weren't talking about coarse-grained services only or fine-grained services only. We had a spectrum, and right? That's a continuum. It really depends on what you want to achieve from a business requirement and modeling point of view. So hopefully these two terms can help us a little bit. So how am I doing, if I may ask, with these pseudocode? This is for now, this is just pseudocode. You can translate it into Java or Swagger contracts, whatever you want. How am I doing in terms of business alignment and agility? Is this understandable for a person without an IT degree? Any opinions? Not understandable? Why not? What's wrong? Yeah? The what? I didn't get that. Do they have to? Just to understand what this thing is doing, right? Prepare customer analysis for meeting. I would argue that this is something the business guy can understand, right? It's not very technical. It's a long name, very expressive name. So hopefully I do okay in terms of business alignment. Agility, that really depends on the job these guys have done. If I go back to this, and they've done an excellent job in organizing their backend according to the domain-driven design principles. The book came out a year later or so, 2003, but anyways. Partitioning the domain model, right? That's what Stefan Tilkoff called distributed domain-driven design, right? They succeeded in organizing this backend into these business functions, COBOL and Qix, by the way, IBM mainframe technology, into discrete units, right? So the site, you can do site effect-free operations on the banking accounts and on the customer records. They don't interfere with each other. They don't create side effects. So that's a big contribution that enabled us to lay out this architecture. Is this independently deployable? Probably. We would need to know more about the implementations, obviously, as you pointed out. Right? That's kind of hard to tell. But that was certainly, we haven't done it too much in the beginning, but it's certainly one of the reasons they organized the backend in this way. And of course, that's another key message here. We do introduce some coupling, right? There's the only decoupled client-server connection is the one that you don't implement, right? By the time you invoke a service somewhere, as was pointed out in the morning too, I think you do depend on that other team and system that provides the API, right? The devil is in the detail, of course, right? Depending on how you organize these collections here, or this DTO set, data transfer object, you might be more or less backward compatible, right? So in terms of qualities, there are big differences, but there's no such thing as a fully decoupled system. That's my message here. And loose coupling certainly has been on our radar and on our mind on this project. I admit that these are somewhat simple. You might have noticed they're all just getters, right? None of these touches the state. They're all just reading data. So let's move on to the next example to make things a little bit more interesting. We're in a different country now. After that project had succeeded and gone in production, I was working for IBM, the professional services organization at that time. They sent me to Australia to help a telecommunications firm, former monopolist, to work on order management and a wholesaler-retailer scenario, right? So the former monopolist, who has the actual physical telephony network hiding behind these rectangles here, these back-end systems, and we're supporting business processes, so longer-running things that can take days, if not weeks, to complete, to organize a relocation, a customer moving to a different house. And you can imagine I'm showing some of these services here, right? First, you validate the address, then you decide whether the phone number can be ported and can be taken with the guy. You might have to schedule some technician appointment to do something with the wiring if you modernize. Quite complex and stateful, right? That's my message here. Sometimes you hear advice like services should be stateless, right? And my argument is, I told you, I will do some myth-busting and some strong opinions. The only truly stateless system is trivial, right? It's things like a pocket calculator or so, or maybe a format converter, like I show up here. Convert domestic to international number format. That's pretty simple. Right? That doesn't need any state management. It gets all it needs in the interface signature, and then returns the new format, right? So this is like, in Stefan Tilkoff's terminology, would easily qualify as a very nice function as a service, right? Cloud architect's dream. Scales like hell because it doesn't have any internal application state to maintain and to transfer and being moved around in the cloud. And this is the other end of the spectrum. Right? This is kind of the other extreme. Right? Very stateful from an application management point of view because you want to know what have I already done? What's coming up next? Am I in the right? Have I met my preconditions if I bring in my criteria here? Are the preconditions met for actually relocating the customer now in these backend systems? Right? So a big thing here was, that's another message I sent with this case study, don't forget the backend connections. They're not all, Netflix might have a few legacy systems, but certainly also they buy some software packages, right? So this vision or illusion or this dream of fully independently deployable services that own their data and only exclusively work with this data, that might work for very simple domain models, very simple applications, but in the real world, at least in my real world, when working with these clients and building enterprise applications, the reality is different, right? You have these backend connections that you have to deal with. I see some people nodding their heads, so it seems we're in agreement. So if you look at these four, how do they differ in terms of microservices, traits, or characteristics that we support and love, like loose coupling and independent deployability. Do they differ somehow, or are they all the same in terms of complexity, or did I a poor job in my service design here? What makes them interesting? How do these four, that seem to be a quadrant kind of suggested, quadrant structure, two dimensions. Anybody gets it? No volunteers? Yes? You got it. Thank you. You could also argue, don't expose these as services, right? I would argue they all have a place in a service architecture, right? They could all be, each of these ports and adapters could be one microservice or one interface within one microservice, and that could be deployed. So that's actually my point, right? So this one, that's why it's the cloud architect's dream, right? No read, no write. And then we have this event processor here. Stefan also had a name for this in his micro keynote in the morning, right? For event processing, only writing, which is difficult enough, but a lot easier than reading and writing and keeping track of where you are, right? And read only, that's very similar to what I showed in the banking case, right? So in these names that I show use here, processing resource, information holder resource, workflow coordinator, they'll be coming back. So my argument is service interfaces, the entire microservices componentry that we put in place, but also the operations that these microservices expose, they do play certain roles in the overall architecture. So actually they have roles and have responsibilities. Terms I didn't come up with. If anybody's old enough like me to remember the days of object-oriented programming and remote objects in the 90s, there was a very nice book by Rebecca Wurst-Brock and a co-author called Responsibility-Driven Design. Right, so this is an homage or makes backward reference to these roles. In that book, roles play in an object-oriented system, but you can do the exact same thing for the roles and responsibilities services take in a service-oriented architecture. So with that, hopefully we have enough ammunition to have some interesting service design discussions later in the talk. Please keep these examples in mind as we move on. So just one chart, it's very busy in terms of text. One I've been showing since 2005, when I did my first SOA and web services tutorial at the Uppsala conference. So what's service-oriented architecture? Definition, I've updated it slightly recently, but not much. And it has some interesting messages in there that we now find in the microservices literature too. Right? So let's go through them very quickly. The good news is, when we come to this topic of definitions, right, there are some. Bad news is each and every consultant and book author and probably firm has a new one and a different one, right? So here's mine with some input from my IBM community, right? So three viewpoints, business analyst, IT architect, and then developer and administrator, right? So we are experts, right? We're all service-oriented computing guys here, otherwise we wouldn't be here at the conference. Just some highlights. So we see something about loose coupling here, we'll get to that in a minute. We emphasize the importance of a contract. That's the examples we have just looked at. My port types there relocated the customer or looked up customer information and stuff like that. And sure, this message of being business aligned or designing interfaces that are meaningful to the domain experts has been with us since this style came to be in the early 2000s. Another key message I have here is sometimes you hear even experienced speakers say something like SOAP is heavyweight and SOAP is a protocol. It's not a protocol, it's a message exchange format. And yes, it's based on XML, but that's just one, the such as matters here. That's just one way of letting services talk. Might not be the most fashionable in recent years, but you still find in backend to backend communication people that value the validation that you get from an XML schema. So it's not dead. But of course, RESTful HTTP dominates and combined with asynchronous message queuing for backend connectivity, right? So my point here is, yes, you can say SOA stands for same old architecture and has been even 15 years ago. And so let's now do an exercise how this translates into our new style or sub-style, I should say, that we're so passionate about, microservices. So I'm going to start with this napkin sketch that I stole from a friend of mine, Gregor Hopi. the author of this book, Enterprise Integration Patterns, when he used to talk about service-oriented architectures, he showed this and says, you know, it's all message-based, so no remote objects, no stubs of whatever kind, plain XML or JSON documents go in. And then you might have some workflow magic that orchestrates services, it transforms the data, and then goes to some application backends. So this is kind of an abstraction or a generalization of the two examples that I've shown, the busy charts that had only rectangles and no hexagons, so there can't be microservices, right? If you only have rectangles, it's not good. Well, I have to do better in the second half of the talk. So fair enough, discovery or registry, right? As an abstract component in the entire system. So if we now run this test, I would argue back here, here it's called applications, but we have the service endpoints. This is what we now refer to as microservices, the things that are independently deployable, reachable over the network with HTTP and JSON and stuff like that. So far, so good. Service registry, I've always been skeptic and critical whether this is really needed. And before I introduce something like this into an architecture, I think twice or three times and then challenge the customer whether they really need that or we can go with a simplified solution. That's bad news for software vendors that sell registries. It's also bad news for researchers that do dynamic service matchmaking or other things that require a registry to be in place. But you know, that's why I said debatable then and now. Yes, there's Eureka and Console and things like that, but not all of us have to reach the same non-functional requirements as some of these super large internet scale systems have, like social network and so on. So be careful. Orchestration, gone. In the last presentation before the lunch break, no, second last, there was this choreography orchestration. I'm not saying this is no longer fashionable, right? Workflow engines, BPMN or so. I haven't seen much in the microservices community. Just be aware that this term is overloaded and repurposed to mean something different. Right? When we hear about orchestration these days, we're talking about service container clustering, right? Things like Kubernetes. This is different here. This is a workflow engine, BPEL or BPMN. Right? So be careful. I've fallen into this trap with a student's project. Right? It took us a couple of maybe days, if not a week, to figure out that our terminology was not in line. It's a polysemy, to cite something from the domain-driven design community. One term used for two different things. That does happen, even in architecture diagrams. What I'm really interested in is, and that stays, and hopefully, so all the things I show next, and when we look at the patterns in the pattern language, they stay, right? That's what stays the same, what is still relevant, what makes or breaks your project is the number of endpoints you put in place, including information about their size, and the messages they understand, right? And the data they send back, right? So this is what I'm really interested in, what we're going to be focused on for the next 15 minutes or so. And this is what our pattern language is all about. Before we can enter that discussion, I promise to do some terminology clarification. Hopefully, we've done this for SOAR. So what's yet to be done is the one for microservices. So more hexagons waiting for us. So this comes from a paper I put out a couple years ago, and you know, when the microservices started to become popular and boom, 2014, 15, I just read definition after definition, right? What have Lewis and Fowler had to say, what Sam Newman in his book has to say, and I kept going. And I tried to look for commonalities, differences, right? And I ended up with seven what I call tenets. The first one would be independent X, right? So independently deployable, scalable, replaceable, or changeable. And if you remember the first presentation, technical presentation of the day by Stefan Tilkoff, he pulled up a chart and showed traits, microservices traits, and all the ones he had are kind of hiding in here. He even had independently deployable and autonomous decentralized decisions. That's all, you know, here in the core. I wholeheartedly agree on this. The next two are slightly changed in viewpoint. This, I could argue this is architectural. These two are, you know, business alignment, meaningful interfaces and abstractions in the technical system, and language of your choice, and also database of your choice. That's something we haven't talked about yet. I say that's brilliant, that's great. As an architect, I support freedom of choice. As long as the big picture stays, you know, manageable and understandable. But my argument here is, and hopefully with my two examples that are a bit dated, I could show that we've been promoting this and doing this for a long time in the service-oriented community. That doesn't mean these are not valuable and important to call out and mention, but not novel. For the next one, and I'm going to go in a bit of detail with this ideal. Yes, there has been innovation, right? If anybody familiar with the 12-factor app by the Heroku guys? Heroku is a cloud provider. If not, look it up, right? 12-factor app, 12 things you should do when you want your application to be able to run in the cloud and use the cloud successfully. So microservices, you know, of course, are an appealing implementation approach to SOA for cloud prospective cloud deployments. So that's something to check out. We're going to do ideal in a minute. So these the first three I'll take for granted for the rest of the talk. This one we're going to spend a couple minutes on, and then the other three I will ignore completely, not because they're not important, but just because it's the service design day today, right? So it's the first keynote. We have development and then deployment up tomorrow and on Thursday, right? So I let the experts like Leif from Nginx talk about containerization and clustering and things like that, right? So this is my collection of microservices tenets, as I call them. That's what I observed in the literature and reverse engineered and can try to distill into my definition, right? Which you can find here in this article, microservices tenets. Can we agree on this for the remainder of the talk as a working assumption that I might have forgotten one or two things, or could have promoted or talked about decentralization or independent decision making a bit more, but I see this as a kind of a corollary, right? If you do the right things in your technical overall architecture and decision making, this puts you in a position to be really agile and autonomous on a design and development level. So that's less prominently featured than in the traits that we saw this morning. All right. Ideal. I said a couple minutes on this acronym. So I got this from friends of mine who wrote a patterns book a couple of years ago, Cloud Computing Patterns, and actually does even more than showing what cloud providers have to offer. For once, it gives a nice definition of loose coupling, right? So ideal stands for isolated state, distribution or decomposition, elasticity, automation, and loose coupling. And then loose coupling, they say, oh, it has four dimensions. Platform, reference, time, and format. And if you're in the distributed systems or integration, you know what I'm talking about, right? Time autonomy you get from using messaging, message-oriented middleware. Format autonomy, the web can help you with MIME types and stuff like that. You still have some hard work to do. Reference autonomy, that's what URIs give us if we use RESTful HTTP. And platform autonomy, well, that's what I tried to show, you know, that this is polyglot programming or polyglot persistence idea. When I write an application that uses the GitHub API or a Facebook API, I couldn't care less whether the server side has been implemented in PHP, Python, Scala, R, whatever have you, or even Java. Doesn't matter for me when I write my client. I write it in the language that I like because it has HTTP support, and it's as long as I can process some JSON, I'm good. So this is what I call for, right? Any services that we design and implement should meet these characteristics. And for the remainder of the talk, we're gonna focus on the coupling dimensions a bit and leave the cloud stuff on the side a little bit. What they also do in that book is they put out a component tree, right? So this is a website that you can use. Parts of the patterns are published. And they send some strong messages about tiers and organizing the application into these boxes here would then be the microservices, right? What they call microprocessing component here. And here they say this one should be stateless. They also have a stateful one somewhere here. But what matters to me here is the message they send that up front here we should have some HTTP. If we go to the web, to the end user, as it was called earlier today, we don't have a choice. We cannot expect people that use the browser and serve the web to install RabbitMQ or ActiveMQ or Kafka clients on their systems. Right? So to the outside world, it's probably going to be HTTP, synchronous protocol, first and foremost. You can configure it to behave asynchronously, but so that's what we're doing here. But from then on, we do messaging, right? So cloud providers provide messaging offerings, or we install our own software that does asynchronous queue-based messaging. Good news for us as pattern language authors is there's APIs everywhere. So when you follow this kind of blueprint for cloud-native application architecture, there's more than one API that you will need to design. And with API, I now mean not only web APIs, but also the messaging endpoints, right? So microservices that listen to queues, do something, and then put something on a different queue, right? If we do request reply. So APIs everywhere. So what's really interesting is what goes back and forth. And that's what we're addressing in our pattern language. So next couple of minutes, I'm going to make things very concrete, right? Give you, I have implemented, in a way, one of the examples from earlier on, right? Hopefully everybody's familiar with curl, right? With this you can send GET requests. So we have a URI here, which gives us reference autonomy. We have an ID here, the customer ID, right? And then in this case it's pretty simple. We don't even need JSON, but on the way back we get a data structure like this back. If this is readable, we might have some links up here that show us what we can do next. If we have multiple results, we can get next slice of data, or it can tell us what the next logical step in the workflow could be. If we do true rest, we have some payload data, actual customer data like birthday and so on. And then, very interesting here, we have a move history, right? If you recall my telecommunications scenario, it was about relocations, right? Customers that keep changing their address. So is this a good idea to include this here, may I ask? Or is this a horrible service design from a data contract point of view? What do you think? Including, I'm following a relationship here, right, from my customer master data to the move history. That might be one to N. Is that a good idea, or is that a horrible design and I should leave the room and not talk about microservices designs anymore? Yes, you're a consultant, so it depends. Always is a very good answer. It actually does depend on what you want to achieve, right? Yes. Yes. It depends on the UI that you're building, right? If I'm building the application that manages the moves, then I'm very interested in this, and I want to get all this in one go, right? I need everything about the client, right? So I want very few calls that return a lot of data. So in my terminology from earlier on, right, from that banking example, I'm looking at a coarse technical granularity, right? If I'm the customer self-service and I just want to see my name or my birthday, right? The basic information, or if I'm a call center agent who has to answer to the client, right? I'm not interested in the move history, right? So it's a bad idea. You send data back that's not needed, and that does happen a lot, right? When you talk to clients, I see some people nodding their heads, right? We've been there. You're not really sure how to design the API. You want to serve multiple clients. You put everything in, right? You expose the entire domain model in the service contract, and then it gets very hard to maintain, right? It's not very evolvable, and it also might performance might suffer, right? And if you go back to the latency discussion, so that's exactly what we're interested in, you know, to lay out this solution space and discuss the pros and cons of the different alternatives and the different options. In fact, we have two patterns for this in the language that I'm going to show very soon. So if we abstract this, again, a reference to the book, right? Integration and middleware in general for service-oriented systems, but also other distributed systems, has been covered by the patterns folks, by the patterns community in great detail, right? For messaging, everything you want to know and maybe don't want to know about asynchronous messaging, you find it in this book by Gregor Hoppe and Bobby Wolf. And they have something called the command message, right? So then even a nice icon sketch, no hexagons, rectangles, but we let them get away with that because it's a book from 2003. But that's where they end. And they say you need to design a command message, but nobody tells us how to design these command messages, or on the way back, the document messages that have this, right? So that's our mission. How do we find the right suited, I say, not the right, there's no right granularity. It really depends what you're up to, the kind of system that you're building, the requirements that you're trying to satisfy. What are good service sizes, and how do we make sure that these contracts that we expose, I've shown you some examples, that they actually promote the loose coupling principle. Any opinions? In the morning we had a talk on data modeling, right? There was a meta model for data modeling. Is there any advice? Is anybody the guys from industry. Do you know of any good book or blog post that tells us how to design this, the message content? Silence is a good in this, because otherwise you'd put me out of the job, right? Yes, you know one. Ooh. Event storming, yes, that's a very nice technique from the domain-driven design community. It's a workshop technique, very collaborative. So you follow one event for the entire system, and then by doing that, you learn more about the data that's needed. That's a good start, but it won't go into the... that's a good start, but this doesn't put us out of the job. I just met Alberto 2 weeks ago, and it won't go to this level of detail, right? So in a way, you can use that as an entry into the discussion I want to have with the pattern language that I will now show in public for the first time, right? So introducing microservices API patterns. Right? So we've been to the, when I say we, it's a community effort. I have 4 co-authors, very hybrid. Half of us are from industry, half of us are from academia or have gone back and forth. So the website went live last Friday, and we'll have a look in a minute. We've organized what we have to say, what we found people using, in 4 categories that are already there and 2 more planned in the pipeline. And this event storming stuff would sit here, right? Identification patterns, domain-driven design. This gives you a list of candidate endpoints and candidate operations. It doesn't say that this is already the right granularity or the right design, but it's a good start. And then we come in and do this black stuff that we had here, right? So we have patterns that represent this on a platform neutral level. Yeah. We have JSON, JavaScript object notation, when we show examples, but we don't want to be limited to that. So we do some data modeling. That's our structure patterns here. Then we have some quality improvements. We'll get to look at these in a minute. As soon as we find out scalability is not good, or this independent deployability tenet suffers, it's not fulfilled, we can do something. So we have patterns to suggest that can help you improve the design. And for this role and responsibility stuff that I already mentioned when I talked about the telecommunications case, the read and write, or read only, write only, that would be represented here in this category. We're also working on, for this year's patterns conference, on versioning and support and lifetime support, and how many versions of the same service and service operations do you want to support and keep alive in production? How do you inform your clients that it's time to move on? Can you hide this complexity completely and come up with tolerant readers and writers, tolerant clients? So that's what the evolution category is all about. But this might be a little too abstract, so I better move on and show an example, right? So one of the first interesting patterns that we have published is pagination, right? We all know this from when using Google Search or so, or Google Scholar. We get the first 20 papers, and then there's a button for the next chunk of data, right? So in UI design, this is very common. In API design, you find it a lot too, even under this name, right? So I should say that you don't invent patterns. You don't create them, you mine them from practice, right? So for like half a year, when I was on sabbatical, I studied a lot of public APIs, like GitHub, Facebook, Jira, lots. We've listed them somewhere. And I found this quite a few times, right? Pagination, under different names, but a large amount of data, right? Maybe you do a wildcarded search for all customers by the name of Zimmermann, and chances are in a German bank you find more than one Zimmermann, and more than 10. So you want to slice the data. And of course, this hopefully improves performance because the messages get smaller, but you have more messages you're dealing with. You maybe need to coordinate. So interesting, in this patterns terminology, forces you're dealing with. And then solution, you slice, you paginate. And there's different ways of doing this. You can have a cursor style or an offset style, right? One is you really work with pages. Or you just work with cursor like next. So interesting variations in the implementation options that we all feature on the website. So I've mentioned the website a couple of times now. Hopefully, I can now switch to it. So here's the 3 categories. Let's see how this works. The laptop decided to think a bit. There we are. Microservice api-patterns.org with two minus in between. We might need to come up with a shortcut. Just went live with the website and put out 14 patterns. For now, we have about 40 drafted and about 10 published at these conferences. So the essence of these already published patterns are on the website. So you might recall the categories by now. This pagination is down here. And I mentioned the quality improvements. Right, let's just have a quick look at our wish list. Wish list. Any idea what that could be? If we look at that icon here, we have these fancy icons, like many pattern authors do these days, to kind of sketch the idea of the solution. What could the wish list be? Yes? Yes, it's poor man's GraphQL. You got it. For GraphQL, we have another a sibling pattern called wish template. That's a bit more sophisticated. The list just literally lists the attributes you're interested in. So you can say, I'm just a customer core management application. I don't care about the move history and the birthday. I just want name, first name and last name, right? Things like that. That obviously makes the request a little bigger, but reduces the amount of data you get back from the server significantly, right? And we've seen it many, many times, right? So as a pattern author, you're supposed to find known uses. If you react, trivial, I've done this 10 times in my programming. That doesn't mean the pattern is poorly designed or written up. That means, excellent, you have a known use for us, right? So it goes like this, and this is the standard format you're supposed to use when you write patterns. Not all patterns also do that, but we have an active active at the conferences, right? So we are really following the template. You say, when is this one eligible? When should I consider this? We have a problem statement. We just talked about this. You get forces, and then you get a solution sketch. Kind of inspired by what the enterprise integration patterns guys do. So you say what you want, and then you get only this. The rest is filtered out. And of course, it's a network, and that's why a website is very appealing. You might solve some of the problems, but you might end up with new problems, and then you have to consider other patterns. Right? So you can then jump to the next one. What we also did is, that's last thing I'm going to show is we have this little animated slideshow. So if this is if you're in a workshop with a client or so and you're not really sure about the design options, you cannot read the entire pattern text, but you go in here, right, and get an executive summary, if you will, an overview, right? So what was wish list again? It's here. So no, laptop friendly or not laptop, tablet friendly way of representing the patterns. Here's the wish list. So like the essence of the pattern. And this looks like PowerPoint or so, but it's actually HTML as well that we generate from our Markdown sources. Anyway, in the interest of time, I gotta go back. So this is a community effort, brand new. Right? We just went live with that website last Friday, I believe. Work in progress, only 14 patterns published, and some gaps here and there. If you have a known use to donate, or you disagree strongly with one of the forces, or say this is a really stupid design, how can we design an information holder that's an anti-pattern? Do let us know. Right, we have a mailing list. You can talk to me. I'm here today and tomorrow. Please help us out, and we should make sure we cross-reference each other from the community side. Going back to the presentation. In the interest of time, I'm going to skip the decision modeling part so that we have a bit of time to talk about open research problems, things that I'm now working on or where I see the community, the research community, hopefully being able to contribute, or at least ideas, or even work on some of these problems. So I'm going to skip the decision part. I'm going to go into domain-driven design and service identification for a couple of minutes. So let's assume that our MAP microservice API patterns are somewhat mature and reasonably designed, right? That give you the options about the whether to include data with that move history or put that in a separate resource in a separate API call. But how does this work together with things like domain-driven design that you get mentioned and already worked? We had the Brandolini reference to event storming that comes from that community. So everybody familiar with domain-driven design? More or less. I have to admit that I read the book when it came out in 2003, and this is the first book. I admire the guy, Eric Evans, for several reasons. One reason being he has a very active community, right? So they meet regularly, they have conferences, practitioners, mostly, I would say. There were two more books, and now even more, right? So people that show how to implement this, show the connection to microservices, good stuff. If you reduce it to its essence, it means it makes a plug for modeling, right? It says we can't just code, we need models, otherwise we can't really facilitate the discussion with the business. Business alignment is back. And it's also object orientation done right. So patterns for how to organize your programs, basically. But, and that's why it gets plucked so much and has had this big comeback in the microservices world. The strategic dimension, and namely the bounded context pattern that I don't have on the slide here, but I have an example coming up. These context maps, right? Here they are. Right, so this is what gets people so excited, and Stefan Tilkroff said distributed domain-driven design, right? When you listen, when you ask, how do you identify services? How do we know how many microservices we need, how many operations? A standard answer is, if you read Sam Newman's book, apply domain-driven design. And what they're not telling us is how you find these bounded contexts, right? So these sort of ovals here, the nodes in the graph are systems or teams. First and foremost, domain-driven design is a philosophy or a set of practices, how to organize your work, scaling at design time. So this could be a team or a system built by that team, right? And you have these relationship types, that's all good, but that's pretty much where it ends. And nobody, if you read that book or even the blog posts and the second generation books, they're not telling you how this leads to a service design. So what I had a student do is, let's look at this. Is write a DSL with the same technology that was featured in the morning, and domain-specific language, to make these context maps machine-readable. And that means you can validate them, you can generate artifacts from them, you can refactor on that level, right? So if we say, oh, this bounded context gets bigger and bigger and has multiple responsibilities now, it will never be independently deployable. You split it, right? You take this context and turn it into two, maybe a cargo context and a booking context. I'm making this up. This comes from the standard example featured in that domain-driven design book. So this is all good, and this helps us to implement something like this. So Michael Plöth from InnoQ, the firm Stefan Tilkoff heads, he has very nice presentations. You find them on SpeakerDeck, where he suggests this, right? So take two patterns from domain-driven design, these context maps with the bounded context that we just looked at, and the aggregates, which is like groups of classes, groups of objects, and meet somewhere in the middle, right? So start from the implementation artifacts and start from these team organization charts and system maps. The example was this one here. Start from this, and then by looking at these edges here, these arrows, you learn about the APIs that are needed and the microservices that you wanna put out. So roughly each of these would translate into one hexagon, one microservice. But my argument is this is a little too high level, right? It doesn't help me in my daily work in workshops, right? So there's room for more, and some ideas I put them on here, right? I'm not going to read all of these. It's an open research problem, right? So I would hope that as a community we can do a little better, and we can come up with some heuristics, some maybe methods. That's still a politically correct term in the Agile community. Probably I better say practices, right? What's the next step after event storming or having drawn one of these? How does this help us with our service design, right? I would argue there's room for tools and method or practice work for the research community. So that would be one of the open research problems that I see, and I've given you one tiny little suggestion here. You know, our context mapper DSL, and that's available as a public GitHub repo to get us started on that journey. In the interest of time, I have 10 minutes left. I can do one more, and then I will have to skip the other two open research problems. So let's talk about decomposition a little bit, right? So my question here is, don't we know enough from our standard software engineering education or software architecture textbooks? I'm listing two of the popular ones here, right? Articles from the 70s, basically. What changes? Or when we are in this world, in the services world, can we just apply these principles, or do we need additional help? Any opinions? For decomposition, for turning the module, the monolith into parts. What are you guys using? You guys that apply microservices in industry to do this. You suggested event storming earlier. How about here? To take the monolith and split it apart. I'm quite critical about the heuristics that you can find online. So this famous two pizza rule, right? It's about the team size. You have to be able to feed the team with two pizzas, otherwise you have to refactor and split the context map and have two teams, that and then according to Conway, you end up with two services, right? Or two components that depend on each other. This is a little too simplistic for me, I would argue, and I have given some more here, right? One reason being, this is not really observable. If I review a system, service-based or traditional, I want to see the style, right? I want to get a feel for the abstractions. And you know, an org chart that shows me the teams doesn't help me that much when doing these code reviews or architecture reviews. So hopefully we can do better. I said open research problem. And I've come up with some advice regarding the most important quality attributes. Anybody familiar with the CAP theorem, CAP, consistency, availability, partitioning? Yeah. So here's ACS, right? So Stefan Tilkoff called this the business scalability, or design time scalability, and then this is runtime scalability. And what I see sometimes being forgotten is that you need consistent data, right? So yes, we have NoSQL in clouds, eventual consistency, but in the systems that I help clients build, these enterprise applications, I'm not amused if my bank account is eventually consistent, right? If the ATM machine tells me, I can't really tell whether you still can withdraw money. There's a message queue between me and the backend. I'll tell you in an hour or so, right? I'm not amused. So this is the kind of consistency I would argue is a good argument. So my high level, you know, this early thinking is maybe we can use these three types of requirements to guide us a little bit, right? So you have to pick, like in the CAP theorem, you can have to pick two out of three, right? If you want business agility and resource consistency, then you create bigger services, right? In terms of roles and responsibilities, if we recall the maps, the patterns from earlier. If you are Netflix and you have to be really super scalable and deployed to production multiple times per day, as they report at conferences, they have a subscription-based pricing model, right? So consistency, who has watched which movie, or it's not really important for the billing, right? Because it's flat rates. So they are up here. So that's why they went the fine-grained SOA or microservices way. And if you value these two and your business is moving a little slower, then maybe you're in a good position with the modular monolith. That's not a term I came up with. It's courtesy of Simon Brown. Go check out his presentations, for instance, at GoTo 2018. And he talks about the modular monolith. So no distribution if it's not really needed. I know. I'm running out of time. So we're not going to do the service cutter, which is a student's project I had that established criteria for system decomposition or service decomposition, combination of functional and non-functional. I only have a minute or so to mention this notion of architectural refactoring, which is not my term. Michael Stahl from Siemens came up with this. He said, you know, code refactoring is a super popular agile practice. We all know it. Hopefully we all do it. Extract method, things like that. To get over the smell of God class. And on the architecture level, it's not that easy because we have models involved. So I did start with this. I have some publications on this that picked up Michael Stahl's thinking. I suggested a template, but what I haven't done yet is to apply this to the microservices world. But actually, I have a web page that's not OpenNet, not public. It's in our internal website. To go from architectural smells, right, things that are not really right in terms of the microservices traits or tenets, and then I suggest patterns that should be swapped in and out. So we go from one design to another. If the messages get too big, take the move history out and apply we call it the linked information holder pattern. If you have too many chatty calls and your network is stressed, do the opposite, go back to an embedded entity, right? That's for the move history. That's what we, the example we looked at a bit earlier. So I've just started this. I'm very interested in opinions. Hopefully some collaborations come out of this. And I won't have time for the service visualization or modeling. I'll save that for an offline discussion, for instance, with the guys here from Dortmund, and they're also active in this space, right? So I didn't make it to the next hexagon, right? The hexagonioning in the interest of time, right? So this is what I have in mind there, right? To visualize services, interfaces, and service the connectors, basically. Yeah? So what we're really interested in, also with our pattern language, is these connectors, the components and the connectors. And of course, our patterns come into play here. Work in progress. I did present a number of research problems as open back in the days, 2007. Remarkably, most of this, that's why I didn't create a new chart, most of these are still open, right? We still have found at best partial answers to these. And with that, I'll just show the summary slide. Thank you for attention. Hope you found this useful and hope for some good and challenging questions. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much for your talk. And okay, I didn't need even to ask.
Thank you for the presentation. Maybe it's a silly question, but do you see microservices only as API providers, or can you do orchestration with microservices?
Which type of orchestration? The Kubernetes clustering?
Functional orchestration, no containers. That's
a very good question. I have this notion when I do my cloud computing lectures of enabling technologies. I would argue that service-oriented architecture is an enabling technology for cloud computing, so is virtualization. And I would say this API design is enabler so that we can come up with microservices of quality and style that meet the requirements in the respective environment they're deployed in, right? So it's a strong, big part of the puzzle, and one few technical writers have looked at this message design. That's what we're doing with MAP. But certainly it's not the only puzzle piece. So we do need work on infrastructure, load balancing, deployments. So a Kubernetes cluster would be a nice deployment infrastructure for these things. And once we have designed these services, but it's not a must. It's not a must have. And that explains my question in the morning to life. And I said, do we always need Kubernetes, or is there room for microservices, deployments, environments that don't use it because they don't have these availability or scalability requirements? Oh, long answer. Sorry for that.
Yeah, thank you for your presentation. So I like very much what you say about the devil in the details. So for example, when you say about the database for the database level with the consistency versus the currentness of the database, or how we can synchronize the database between the microservices and so on. So can you share more your views on that, and are there any kind of patterns that we can use for those database level?
Good question, because it gives me a chance to show the hexagon. So let's assume we have customer data stored in here, right? These are not applicable, but let's assume we have a copy of the master data is here, right? The actual owner of the customer data is this service. I call it customer core. This comes from a fully implemented example, by the way, Spring Boot based, that we have out on GitHub. And we have local copies here. So one way, obviously, is through the service interface. You just ask via HTTP or via a message queue, right? You can also do background replication here, right? And in the self-contained systems community, that's what they recommend, right? That periodically you replicate data. Of course, that's a management challenge, not to say nightmare. It's difficult to achieve, right? Because if only this guy writes, this is okay, right? You just send copies over here. But if both of them write simultaneously, we're back to the old days where we were fighting about distributed two-phase commit and whether that's a good idea or not, right? Even in my distributed systems before SOA, I was very reluctant to use distributed two-phase commit for operational reasons. The only place where I can accept that is taking stuff out of a queue and dumping it to the database, right? So that you can put that into one system transaction. Event sourcing would be a big architectural pattern or approach. Event sourcing, of course, it has latency and no guarantees, right? If you use message queuing, that's good, but you can still end up with conflicts, right? And there's no simple solution. So you got to talk to your client, and when you follow the events through the system in a workshop like event storming, you ask, what's more important to you, data freshness or data consistency, right? Assuming that you hold copies or have distributed copies and cannot manage to organize into discrete units. Yeah.
So we have time for another question.
Well, it's just a provocation kind of.
Oh, excellent.
So
I love them.
Can you go back to the slide of the triangle with that you mentioned, the cap? So I sometimes, well, I have a course on microservice and DevOps, and I teach to the students the cap theorem.
Yes.
And it's difficult often to explain to them that, well, among the three qualities, there are few systems that requires consistency. Even ATMs, for instance, these days are not totally consistent. And in this, if you think at your analogy and your triangle, which one are the most important one in a system? And if you have to start to develop a system here, I think business is a big issue, and also like the fact that is scalable. Can
yes.
we say that microservice could be the default solution if you don't have any strong arguments to go for the other, the resource consistency?
Maybe the ATM was a better example, because the ATM machine is a front end, right? So, and if we talk about two back ends, right, or a redundantly deployed where the master data is, where the single systems of record is the term that's used, right? Yeah. Yes. Even Brewer has a new article out, right? CAP theorem, 12 years after 12 years or so revisited, and with advances in cloud storage. I see your point. My message here was not that I promote this to be the most important one, and I will not answer. I will just say, make it a conscious design decision. Talk to your client to get a feel for what's acceptable and what's most important, right? And so don't just follow the simple path and pick the first solution. Be aware of the trade-offs and find the compromise that works best for your environment. I would say services, long-lived services. But Stefan had the four incarnations, right? From FAS to micro, and then distributed DDD, and then the SCS. And I've given you three here, right? Three options. So I wouldn't be able to name a favorite here. Services are here to stay. I'm quite confident about that. For a couple years, it was a little more quiet and more calm. Other topics were more interesting and relevant. But this comeback has been phenomenal, right? Since 2014, Lewis and Fowler have succeeded with their community in getting a momentum going, and it's hard to avoid the term these days. So services are here to stay, but they can have any granularity or size that makes sense in your current setting. That's a nice way of ending this, I would say. Oh, there's one more.
I just wanted to make a small comment. So I agree. But I also wanted to defend a bit resource consistency that lately has been so vast. I think I've come to appreciate that it makes a system simpler. If you have a system with resource consistency, if you cared about that, sometimes your code base is significantly simpler when you think about what
yes.
you have to do than code bases where you didn't think
yes.
about it, because you still have to do eventual
yes.
consistency. You cannot just get rid of consistency entirely.
Yes.
Your system cannot be random, right?
Good point.
So an eventual consistency is bloody hard to get right.
Yes.
So if you don't need eventual consistency, my advice would be to stay away from it as much as possible, to be
yeah.
honest.
Excellent point. And in that paper, microservices tenets are called this cognitive load. If we do all these fancy things, right, you have to explain all this to the team. That might be you, if you do products, not projects, but it might be somebody else that maintains and evolves this, right? And if you need a couple days to explain your eventual consistency strategy, and there's no need. The cognitive load is a quality attribute in a way, or the complexity of the design that you end up with. So, microservices API patterns.org help is very much welcome. I thank you very much for your and for the active discussion and the good feedback.
Thank you very much, Olaf.